I want to get one thing very, very clear at the start here. These instructions in these verses here and elsewhere in the New Testament, these are not optional. You need to understand that the person who rejects what God says here and elsewhere rejects God. For Christians, the only place for sex is with the person that you are married to. Just a warning here, I get fed up with believers that come and see me as a pastor and come and plead with me, say, well, our situation is a bit different, Pastor. We're so much in love together. We're going to spend the rest of our lives together. You know, God's love fills us, and God's love fills us with one another. And so we're sure that it's okay before God that we're having sex, even though we're not married. I've lost count the number of people who have said that to me over the years.
This is GBC Web TV, on the internet at gbcweb.tv. Welcome to Greenford Baptist Church in West London. Here you can watch inspired biblical teaching and find out how to apply God's Word to your everyday lives. On the website you can also listen to audio versions of these programs or download them as podcasts. Today's program is called Holy Sex, 1 Thessalonians chapter 3 verse 6 to 4 verse 8 by Pastor David Wise.
Father God, as we come to look at your word this morning, we ask that you are going to speak to us. Father, as always we pray, we don't just want to gain information this morning, we actually want revelation from yourself. We want you to speak into our hearts and minds. Father, open our eyes, open our spiritual eyes to hear, to see, spiritual ears to hear. Father, you will touch our lives as we look at your living word this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, we're going back this morning to the series in 1 Thessalonians. Just a recap, because it's been a few weeks since we looked at this. We've had Easter in the meantime. 1 Thessalonians was probably the very first part of the New Testament to be written. It was probably written less than 20 years or around 20 years after Jesus's death and resurrection. The context was that Paul and Timothy with Silas had visited Thessalonica to tell them about Jesus. He'd planted a church there, new converts. However, there was major opposition to Paul, and he suddenly had to leave Thessalonica hastily and suddenly, and had been unable to return. A little while later, he sent Timothy to visit the young church, and Timothy came back and gave news to Paul. And as a result of that, Paul wrote this letter, which we know as 1 Thessalonians, to the church there. Now, when I was here last time, teaching on Thessalonians, I said to you, well, in fact, the time before last, I said to you, I want you to make sure that you read 1 Thessalonians all the way through in one go. Make yourself a nice cup of tea, cup of coffee, whatever, and you read it all the way through. Then when I was here last time on 1 Thessalonians, I asked how many people had done that, and it wasn't very impressive. So I said to you that the next time I'm teaching on 1 Thessalonians, I'm going to ask the question again. So how many of you in the last couple of months have sat down and have read 1 Thessalonians all the way through from start to finish? If you've done that, can you put your hand up? Higher. Well, that's some. Okay, rest of you, thank you very much, and I'm very pleased that you've done that. Was it helpful? Yeah? Did you find as you read it through what the teaching suddenly made more sense because it was in context? Yeah? So the rest of you, take due notice. Here's your homework. Sometime this week, make yourself a nice cup of tea, cup of coffee, or whatever it is. And or when you're on the aeroplane, your Bible out and read 1 Thessalonians all the way through. It won't take you long. It's only a short letter. But it's important that you see it as a whole letter. We're just looking at a section at a time as we go through. But it's important you see it as a whole letter. So take it and do that. Normally at this point, I'd ask for a recap on what you remember from last time, but as it was 4 weeks ago, I'm not going to do that. I'll give you what you need to know as a recap as we work through this morning. So we're starting in chapter 3 and verse 6. Timothy has just now come to us from you and has brought good news about your faith and love. He has told us that you always have pleasant memories of us and that you long to see us just as we also long to see you. Therefore, brothers, in all our distress and persecution, we were encouraged about you because of your faith. For now we really live, since you are standing firm in the Lord. How can we thank God enough for you in return for all the joy you have in the presence of our God because of you? Night and day we pray most earnestly that we may see you again and supply what is lacking in your faith. This is the return that I talked about in the introduction. This is when Timothy comes back. He's just now come to us from you. And he's brought good news about your faith and your love. You may recall that Timothy, Paul had been really anxious about this church. He'd conducted this campaign there. He talked about Jesus. He'd seen many people accept Jesus into their lives. And then suddenly he had to leave them. He had no contact with them. Didn't have mobile phones in those days. Couldn't ring up and say, you know, how's it going? And he'd been praying for them. And he was worried that this church may have given in to the persecution that was going on that had caused him to have to leave. Eventually he sends Timothy. Timothy comes back and brings really encouraging news. Paul was having a really hard time. We know from elsewhere that he was finding life very difficult. Remember, we saw last time how for us as Christians, trials and difficulties are a normal part of life. Now, sometimes we think it a strange thing when something difficult happens to us or happens in our family, but it's a normal part of life. A normal part of life. But the amazing thing for those of us who walk with God is that God has this incredible way of taking hold of whatever difficulty comes our way, whatever problem comes our way, and using it for our eternal good. Amen? Sometimes we can't see that at the time. Sometimes it feels really difficult at the time. But God has this way of taking hold of things and using them for our good. Because his heart is out to bless you. His heart is out for your good. But that doesn't mean you don't experience difficult things. But he has a way of taking those things and bringing good out of them, as he did for Paul back here in this time. You can see a little glimpse in these verses into Paul's prayer life. Verse 10, 11, 12 and 13. We'll look at 11, 12 and 13 in a few moments. But verse 10 tells us a little bit about Paul's prayer life. It wasn't something he just did every now and then. It says, night and day we pray most earnestly. And he's praying for the Thessalonians. We'll see some of what he was praying in a few moments' time. We look at verses 11 through to 13. And he says, we pray most earnestly that we may see you again and that we may supply what is lacking in your faith. From elsewhere in the letter, we know that there were gaps in the young church's understanding, and Paul wants to plug those gaps. We know that one of those big gaps, and we'll see more of this later in the letter, is about their understanding about Jesus' return, when he was coming back, how that was going to happen. More of that later in the letter. And secondly, we know there were gaps in their lifestyle, the way their lifestyle reflected God's purposes for them. And again, we're going to see more of those things as we work through the letter. And this is what Paul prayed for them. Now, may our God and Father himself and our Lord Jesus clear the way for us to come back to you. First request. Second request. May the Lord make your love increase and overflow for each other and for everyone else, just as ours does for you. Third request, may he strengthen your heart so that you will be blameless and holy in the presence of our God and Father when our Lord Jesus comes with all his holy ones. We're going to take a few minutes to look through this prayer because this was Paul's prayer for the church there, but actually also there are things in here that apply to us just as strongly. And we're going to talk together. If you're here in teaching that I'm doing for the first time, I should explain that at various points as we go through, I stop and ask questions and we talk about things together. And there are two of those questions coming in the next few minutes. The first request we see here was Paul asking to be able to visit the Thessalonian church again. We know from elsewhere that his prayer was answered. But it was 5 years before he was able to go back and visit the church. The second prayer is this, the second request. It's in verse 12, look at it again. May the Lord make your love increase and overflow for each other and for everyone else, just as ours does for you. It's a prayer that God's love would so fill the individuals who were part of the church that it would overflow to one another as part of the church, and it would then overflow outside the fellowship. Now, if Paul was praying for us today, he would probably be praying a similar thing for church here. So here's the question. I want you to read that verse again and think about this. Thinking about the church family here that we're a part of. We're known here as a church that is really welcoming. We're known here as a church that loves other people. I was talking to some people yesterday who I was just talking about how they came to be a part of this church and how the first time they walked in here, just the welcome they received. They hadn't planned to come to this church. They planned to go somewhere else, but something happened and they ended up here on a Sunday morning and they felt so welcome. They just continued to come here and found God blessing them here. So it is true that we're a welcoming church. It is true that God's love, they talked about how since that time, some of the difficulties that they faced, how they've been supported. They named various people in the church here who've been caring for them, who've been praying with them. But we know that we're not perfect as a church family. We want to see more of God's love in us and expressed through us. So here's the question. If this was more and more true for us as a church family here, seeing God's love increasing and overflowing more and more, what would it look like? How would people that came along and saw Greenford Baptist Church here, how would they know? What evidence would they see of God's love overflowing between people who are part of the fellowship and overflowing outside? What does it look like? Because in our culture, we often use the word love to talk about some mushy form of romantic feeling. Nothing wrong with mushy romantic feelings, by the way. But that isn't what's being talked about here. This is about God's love. And God's love is not mushy and romantic feeling. God so loved the world that he didn't feel all gooey about it. He so loved the world, he sent his son to live and die for us. It's that sort of love. So it's not about warm, fuzzy feelings. It's about activity. It's about things that happen coming out of God's love. So, what would be the hallmarks of a church family, us, some other church family, where God's love is so powerfully flowing between people and flowing, overflowing outside? What do you think? Could you say that again? Yeah.
There'll be unity in the church.
Unity.
Because of the love that we have for one another.
Okay, very good. What else?
Yeah. A lot of selfless acts being done.
Selfless acts. What sort of things? One or two examples.
I don't know, like you see your sister or brother going through hardship, and if you have the means that you try and help them and meet them at the point of their needs.
Okay, very good.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I was going to say support for each other, reaching out to each other. As my sister here said, during difficult times, being there for each other, yes.
Okay, very good. What else?
It's maybe making a meal for a new mum that, you know, is having a hard time, and you just make dinner for her and her family so that they don't have to worry about it. It's actually sort of doing the family caring thing, and not only in the church, but actually taking it out to your neighbour or whatever.
Yeah. One of my memories, very powerful memories for me, is when Leslie and I moved into the first house we've been renting. In South, we moved into the first house that we'd bought. And we moved in during the day. And in the evening, there was a knock on the door, and there was an elderly couple there who were part of the church we were going. And they'd baked us a huge apple pie and a casserole. They hadn't asked us. They'd just done it, and they just brought it along. Said, thought you'd want something to eat today. And that just meant so much. We hardly knew these people, and yet they knew we were moving, and they just did that. So it's that sort of thing, isn't it? Yeah, thank you. It's a very good example. What else? Anything else? Yeah, Elaine.
I think the toddler group's probably a huge example of that. I think, you know, it shows our love, and there's been a lot of comments.
It might be helpful just to say that we have this group here that meets on a Tuesday, that there are loads and loads of parents. This building here is absolutely packed with parents and carers and children. We've been running that for a number of years. You're the main leader of that currently, so just helpful for people who didn't know that. So, say again.
I think, you know, it shows... You know, people come inside this building that probably wouldn't otherwise come inside the building. And there are lots of people of many faiths. I've given up counting the languages that come through the door. And people that are just curious, you know. And this building can seem quite closed. And I think the walls almost need to come down so that people can see inside the building.
So how do they experience God's love when they come here to the toddler group, do you think?
I think there is an atmosphere in this building. I think God is here in some way, and I pray about that more and more, that people will meet God. That people notice something different here that isn't anywhere else. I don't think they always know what it is, but I think people sense that. And we are open that we will pray for people afterwards, and people do. People say, pray for me. And I think we need to be more open to that as a church.
Right. Great example there of God, you know, falling out, if you like, of people, God's love falling out wider into the community. I'll just take one more.
Phone calls during the week, not just meeting up on Sundays and smiling and having tea together.
So it's thinking of people during the week and caring for them during the week. Okay. Lots of good things. The third request that we're going to look at in some detail, is this one in verse 13. Look at it again. May he strengthen your heart, that you will be blameless and holy in the presence of our God and Father when our Lord Jesus comes with all his holy ones. Blameless and holy. This is about being ready to meet with Jesus when he returns, ready to meet him. And it's the image here is about Jesus coming back to earth and bringing with him all the saints, all of those that have died in Christ, coming with him back to earth. And that those who are still alive in Christ on the earth are rising up and meeting him, and the people on the earth being as blameless and holy as those saints that are coming back with Jesus. And this is, again, something that is without doubt God's will for us. Poses the question, are we ready to meet Jesus when he returns? Some of you will have heard me ask this question before in this form, so it's revision for some of you. If you knew that Jesus was coming back Tuesday afternoon, this is not a prophecy, this is going to happen, but if you knew that Jesus was coming back this coming Tuesday afternoon at 2:30, and the world as it now is coming to an end, what would you do differently between now? Just think, I don't want answers to this, just think about this. What would you do differently between now and 2:30 on Tuesday afternoon. Just think about that for a moment. If you knew, if God spoke this morning and led us in to know, and he's not going to do this, but if he did do this, say, you know, Jesus coming back next Tuesday, 2:30 in the afternoon, and the world as it now is going to be wound up. How would you live differently between now and next Tuesday? Just think about that for a moment. Here's the shocking thing. I don't know how long your list is, but there shouldn't be anything on your list at all. Because you should be living as though you are ready for Jesus' return at any moment. Because you don't know when he's coming back. And he could come back at any time. And the question is, are you ready to meet Jesus when he's returned? This was Paul's prayer for the Thessalonical church, this church made up of new converts there, that they would be ready for Jesus when he returned. They would be holy and blameless. So, what should our lives look like? Here's the question. What should our lives look like to be ready for Jesus when he returns? Which is not about something that we should be doing in the future, but it's how we should be living now. Amen? Because he could come back this afternoon. Are you ready? What should our lives be? This is the question. How should our lives be to be holy and blameless and ready for Jesus at his return? What should our lives look like?
Patch.
As Christians, children of the Most High God, I think we should all live out each day as if it's the last day in this land.
Okay, I agree with you. We should be living each day as though it is the last day.
Yes.
What does that mean? How does that make a difference?
Being prepared, being living your life to God, praying, watching and praying. Because in a moment when we think not, Son of Man will come.
Okay. What else? Yeah, lady.
I think to be conformed to the image of Christ Jesus, to walk just like Christ did while he was on earth.
Okay, so our lives should be looking like Jesus looked. Yeah, very good. What else? Sandra.
Telling others about Jesus and to get them ready for when he comes.
Yeah, because when he comes back, it's going to be too late, isn't it, for other people. So we need to be telling people. The evangelist behind you is saying amen very loudly. We need to be telling other people about Jesus.
Yeah
absolutely.
Amen.
Josh.
Like forgetting about worldly stuff and not worrying about it. Because I was thinking if Jesus was coming back on Tuesday, you know, would I be thinking, oh, I've got to go to work today? I mean, obviously, I'm not saying don't go to work, but I'm saying that isn't the important thing. The important thing is being radical and out there and talking to people. And if you're in work, you're in there for a reason to evangelize and not just earn money, you know?
Yeah, very good. Very good. It is about what our priorities are. I mean, later in Thessalonians, Paul writes that people shouldn't just be sitting around doing nothing, that they should work. But our focus is on the horizon. Our focus is on the fact, the reality of Jesus and his return. Anything else? Okay. So if when you thought about that question earlier on, there were things on your list, I'd like to suggest to you, you talk to God about those things, so that if I ask you the question again, which I probably will at some point in the future, there's nothing on your list, because you should be living ready for his return. And if you knew he was coming back in a few hours' time, it shouldn't make any difference to how you live. Amen? Living blameless. Chapter 4 brings us to a new section of Thessalonians. In this final two chapters, Paul is giving teaching about what Christians' lives ought to live like, ought to be like, what the Thessalonians, how they should live out their lives. And the very first subject he picks up is the subject of sex. Now, in their society, immorality was rife. A man typically had sex with his wife, had sex with his female slaves, and had sex with temple prostitutes. That was normal. A lot of men would also have a mistress as well as a wife, so very promiscuous. Pagan worship in the temples, it was true of the main cult in Thessalonica, as it was true in many others. Sex was a major part of worship. So all sorts of sexual actions took place in the context of worship. And so that was the context of their society. In some ways a bit different from ours, but in other ways not that different. And this is how Paul began to address those issues in their society. Chapter 4 and verse 1. Finally, brothers, we instructed you how to live in order to please God, as in fact you are living. Now we ask you and urge you more in the Lord Jesus to do this more and more. For you know what instruction we gave you by the authority of the Lord Jesus. Our society here in the UK and probably in much of our world is obsessed with the importance of people enjoying and pleasing themselves. It's about what makes me happy. It's about what I enjoy. It's about finding that enjoyment. And you've only got to look at, stand in a newsagent and look at the magazines that are available and look at the stuff that's on the covers there. And it is all about things that people can do to enjoy life more, to please themselves more. Life revolves around that for so many people. We were away at a conference last week. I was away with a couple of the leaders here. We were staying in a city centre, and in common with most other city centres, on the Saturday night, the city centre is full of young people in their 20s, some of them in their 30s, some of them even older, who are out just to have a fantastic time, which seemed to include getting absolutely drunk, making a huge amount of noise, and all the rest of stuff that goes on. But for them, the whole thing they were there was just for pleasure, for themselves. And I feel like it's a little picture of what our society is like. But as Christians, our lives ought to be different. Our primary purpose, says Paul here, how we live is to live in order to please God. It's not about pleasing ourselves, it is about pleasing God. And that's our primary purpose. Now the question, sometimes when we're unsure what to do in a situation or in a context, I know we have this question, what would Jesus do? Another question to ask is, what would please God? What would bring most pleasure to God? Because that's what we're here to do. So here's another question. If we look at the lifestyle of Christians who are living in order, first and foremost, to please God, in contrast to the lifestyle of lots of other people around us who are living first and foremost to please themselves, what are the big differences in those two lifestyles? Between people who are focused on pleasing God and people who are focused on pleasing themselves, what are the differences, primary differences, do you think? Valentine, let me come around to you.
Those living in the fear of the Lord, their actions will speak louder than their words.
Okay. Could you give an example of that?
Take for instance, see somebody who, now you're a Christian and you have that will to help, to give, to reach out to people, I think that speaks better.
Okay. Can I ask you a question? You've just started a new job And I know you're in training at this stage, but for you, part of what you want to do is to please God. So how do you work that is different? You know, some people, when they're working, their soul... This is going to be an all right question. I can see you looking a bit anxious here.
No.
Some people, when they're working, all they're looking for is their wage packet. Okay, they're working just to get money so they can go out and do whatever they want to do. But when Christians work, yes, we get a wage packet, but actually our primary reason for working is not for the wage packet, it is to please God. So in this new job that you're just doing training for now, how does that change the way you see the job?
Well, I think it makes me think that for everything that happens is because of God's will,
okay,
not because of mine or any other
right
thing ordinarily.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay, how else then? What are the other differences in lifestyle between people who are focused on pleasing themselves and people that are focused on pleasing God? What are the differences in lifestyle? Yeah, Sophie.
Again, selfishness against selflessness, in terms of you're thinking more of others and doing what's right to help others rather than just thinking of your own gain. So that should be reflected in your lifestyle as well.
Okay, very good. Yeah, I see that hand. Steve.
What I'd say is similar to what Sophie said, but you'll be listening to God and asking him, what do you want me to do with my life, and putting action towards it in your lifestyle.
Okay. Fiona?
You might have a different management style to other people because you'll be building up other people and building up the best for them and putting business concerns slightly to different. So it'll be a different management style to what's popular.
Yeah. That's a very important point, actually, because a lot of people in their workplace, they're just wanting to climb above everybody else.
Yeah.
Whereas for us as Christians, we're wanting everyone else to succeed as well.
It's a very simple thing, treat others how you want to be treated. So if you want to be treated with respect, you're going to treat others with the respect that you think you get.
And very
so
good.
Change your management style.
Very good.
There is a funny thing when you talk about this, because I've been asked so many times, what's so good to be a Christian? What's the pleasure on this? And then I reply back straight away, say, what's the good for you to don't be a Christian? Because what are you going to end up with? So on your days off or stuff like that, they go like, nah, I go out, I get drunk, and do this, I do that. Especially because in your case, because I work as a builder. So that's all about for them.
Mm-hmm.
They have a day out, go to football match and stuff like that, and get drunk. And when they come back on Monday or something, they hardly can walk.
Can't even remember what they were doing.
That's
yeah
it. So on the other day, well, actually this week, someone asked me, what's the good about that? I said, listen, whenever you become a Christian, I can show you what's the good about that. If you don't do it, you're never going to know. I feel really sorry for you.
Okay, very good. Thank you. Yeah.
As a Christian, you don't have to earn a lot, but you're content with what God gives you, and you have peace in mind. With the other side, they don't have that peace. They're always looking for that fix to just satisfy them.
Okay, very good. Thank you. Teresa.
As a Christian, living for Christ, it makes you feel that you're matured. People see you as matured. As for them, they are old, but their thinking cap is very, very slow. I mean, it's low. They see you as somebody who knows more, even though you are young than them. They see you as a mature person. They see you as wise. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much. Hand over. Oh, there it is. I saw someone's hand over here.
As Christians, I think we should be prepared to walk against the crowd, not walk along with the crowd in most of the time,
okay,
in most cases.
Because we need to be following what God is saying to us.
Yes, that's
yeah
right.
Okay, very good. Very good. Just two more. Yeah, I'll be over there in a moment. So.
You should work for your, or endeavour to work for your employees as you're working for, as if you were working for the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
So whatever your brief is, you should be looking to fulfil that.
Yeah. Where that makes a difference is in some contexts, people are trying to do the minimum they can do
to get away. And they've got a different agenda. It's about them, their self-promotion and...
Yeah. Whereas for us, ultimately, our employer is God. And so whatever job we're doing, whether we're a builder or whatever else it is, we're working for God first and foremost.
Do our best.
Yeah, very good. And finally, Christine.
In line with what my brother there said, like I'm using myself as an example in my place of work. As a Christian, I'm seen as being boring, you know, because I've been told more than once that my lifestyle is very boring, you know. Because, you know, when they talk about, like on the Sunday, Saturday night to Sunday, you're not going anywhere. You know, I say, okay, if I can attend prayer meetings or something, then on Sunday I go to church. It's like, that should be a very, very boring style of life.
So they don't know what they're missing, do they?
Oh, they don't know. They don't know. They're missing a lot. Because to me, most of them are half dead.
Yeah. Yeah, very good. Very good. They think you're boring, they're half dead. Okay, thank you. The next few verses we're going to look at, this next passage, talk about what pleasing God means in practice in terms of our sexual behaviour. Now, if you read the different versions, different Bible versions you've got here, you'll notice that in these verses there are some big differences in the way they're translated. And there are a couple of verses in here, particularly verse 4, that is quite difficult to translate. Now, I'm not going to go into why I'm following the interpretation that I'm following today. It's technical, and I'm not going into all of that. But just to say that everything I'm going to say from this point on, not only you find it in this passage here, but you find it elsewhere in the New Testament as well. And it reflects the Bible's teaching on that. So let's go into verse 3. It is God's will that you should be sanctified, that each of you should avoid sexual immorality, that each of you should learn to control his own body in a way that is holy and honourable, not in passionate lust like the heathen who do not know God. And in this matter, no one should wrong his brother or take advantage of him. The Lord will punish men for all such sins, as we have already told you and warned you. For God did not call us to be impure, but to live a holy life. Therefore, he who rejects this instruction does not reject man, but God, who gives you his Holy Spirit. Now, all the way through this passage, wherever you find brother, you can also read sister. Wherever you see the word man, you can also read woman. It applies the same all the way through. I want to get one thing very, very clear at the start here. These instructions in these verses here and elsewhere in the New Testament, these are not optional. You need to understand that the person who rejects what God says here and elsewhere rejects God. For Christians, the only place for sex is with the person that you are married to. Just a warning here, I get fed up with believers that come and see me pastor, and come and plead with me, say, well, our situation is a bit different, pastor. We're so much in love together. We're going to spend the rest of our lives together. You know, God's love fills us, and God's love fills us with one another, and so we're sure that it's okay before God that we're having sex, even though we're not married. I've lost count the number of people that have said that to me over the years. Their situation is different. The Bible is very clear. Verse 6, the last part of the verse, is very, very clear indeed. This is God's word. This is not the pastor having a go. The Lord will punish men for all such sins, as we have already told you and warned you. It's very clear. The only place for sex for Christians is in the context of marriage, the person that they are married to. Very clear. It actually talks here about having sex outside of marriage is robbing people. Having sex with someone before they're married, the way that it's talked about here, is robbing their future marriage partner of the privilege of being the first person to share sexual intimacy with that person. That's what's being said here. So it's not just about the now, it actually is about robbing for the future. Having sex with someone who's married to someone else is clearly also robbing. Clearly is doing wrong to their husband or wife. One of the commentators that I read this week has got this sentence. It says, selfish sexual motives are often masked by sincere professions of love. Selfish sexual motives are often masked by sincere professions of love. I could tell you so many, I'm not going to tell you any, but I could tell you so many stories of situations that I've been involved with over 25 years of pastoral ministry. In fact, slightly longer than that, if you include the time before I was a full-time pastor, when I was working in another church. Of families that I have seen damaged, people's lives that I've seen messed up because of sex outside of the place that God created it for. I could tell you story after story. And I could tell you examples of people who, I've got one in my mind at the moment, who, church member, I'm not going to say whether it was this church or the previous church, but just remember this particular context, this church member who I challenged because of the fact that they were having sex with their person that they were with, to whom they weren't married. And I got all of this stuff about God's love and all the rest of it. And a few years later, lost contact with them. A few years later, they asked to see me. And we actually met up not far from here, in a coffee shop. And one of the things they wanted to say to me was that they regretted that they hadn't listened. Because actually, that relationship hadn't worked. And in fact, not only had it not worked, it had done huge damage to them, to their relationship with God, and to them as a person, which they were now having to sort out. And I could tell you lots and lots of things like that. God's word is very clear, and it's very clear for a reason there. Our society seems to believe that unless you're having sex, you are unfulfilled and there is something wrong with you. This is a lie. It's a myth that our sex-mad society throws around all the time. That unless you're having sex, you are unfulfilled and there is something wrong with you. When I've talked previously on the issue of sex, which I haven't done for some time, I remember having two singles, a single guy, a single woman, both in their mid-20s, and just asking them about how their lives were with the fact that, I mean, they were both virgins, they'd never had sex with anybody, how their lives were like that. And they were talking about how their lives were fulfilling. And in fact, they wanted to keep themselves for the time when they met the person that they married and then they were going to have sex. And it is quite possible to live as a Christian, a single Christian, a fulfilling life without sex, despite the lie that is told us by our society. But more of that on another occasion, because I want to take another issue here. There's another really important aspect here. This passage teaches very clearly that sex within marriage should be holy and honourable. I want to say that from God's perspective, mine as well, sex is good. Sex is very good. God invented it after all. God designed, people forget this, God designed men and women so they could enjoy sexual intimacy with their husband or wife. God didn't have to make us the way that he made us. He could have made us different. But he didn't. He made us as we are. He made us so that we can have that sexual intimacy and sexual enjoyment with our husband and wife. Now, normally at this question, I would ask a question. The question I would have asked would have been this question. For you, what makes sex in marriage holy and honourable as opposed to not holy or dishonourable? But I thought if I asked that question here this morning, it might go a bit quiet. So what I've done is I've asked a number of people during the week, most of whom, in fact, I think all of them, are here in the congregation this morning. And I'm going to read to you what they've said to me. Because this is an important issue. You know, sometimes Christians are tarred with this idea or that we say that sex is somehow dirty or that it's something that is you know, a necessary evil or something like that. That isn't what the Bible teaches at all. The Bible celebrates the beauty of sexuality and sex between husbands and wives. So I asked a number of people, what is it that in your marriage makes sex holy and honourable? What are the things, what are the hallmarks of sex that is holy and honourable? So here are some of the answers. Holy, set apart for each other. Your husband is set apart for you. You are set apart for your husband. It's within an exclusive and intimate relationship. It's wanting the best for the other. It's honouring the other. It's putting their needs first and knowing that his motivation is that too. It's enjoying each other. Enjoying what God has brought together. Knowing that my husband loves me and feeling completely free and safe within the relationship. The sex comes out of the relationship and is shaped by it, rather than sex shaping the relationship. Here's somebody else. Embracing the fact that sex is a wonderful gift from God that allows husband and wife to actually become one. Here's a third person. Remembering that sex is about loving my wife. It's not about me and my needs. And finally, the fourth one. Not withholding sex from my husband. In 1 Corinthians 7, Paul says that neither husband nor wife should deprive the other of sexual intimacy. In the same vein, I should not use sex to get my own way or as a bargaining tool, as that is not honouring to God. Four different perspectives from people who are here this morning about how in their marriages, sex can be holy and honourable. You know, even in the bedroom, our lives should be lived in a way that pleases God. We sometimes make, you know, segment our lives that somehow it's pleasing God is about, you know, what we do on a Sunday morning between 10 and 12:30 or what we do when we have our quiet time during the week. But actually it is about, as people were saying earlier on, every single aspect of life being lived in a way that pleases God. And that includes our sexuality and our expression of that. And as Christians, we should celebrate and enjoy sex as a wonderful gift for married couples to enjoy together. Now, I appreciate that some of the things that I've said in the last 10-15 minutes may well, for some of you, have brought to the surface some big issues. You may disagree strongly with some of the things that I've said. It may actually have highlighted issues in your own life, whether you are single or if you are married, where things are not as they ought to be, where you are just aware that it falls short of God's purposes for you. And I just want to encourage you, after we finished this morning, you may want to grab hold of one of the staff here or one of the leadership team here, either have a brief conversation with them now or say, actually, can we get together at some point? Can we talk about some of these things from this morning? Don't let those things, if they've come to the surface in response to God's word here, don't allow those things to sink back down underneath the surface. But actually allow God's Spirit to work so that your life becomes more and more as God intended it to be, pleasing to God. So let's begin to pull together the things that we've learnt this morning from this passage in Thessalonians. What are the key things, what are the main things that we take away from this morning that we take into our lives this week and beyond? What are the key things for you that have come out of this morning that we take on from this morning? Sarah. It's getting further and further to walk to the back.
As Christian, our main purpose is to please God.
Yeah, very good. As Christians, our main purpose is to please God. What else have we learned this morning? What are the key things? Jane, let me come over to you.
That God only wants good things for us.
Yeah. To please God is to go that extra mile, like further than everyone else.
Yeah, very good. What else? Elaine.
It's about being holy enough to be brave enough to let the doors of this church open so that people can see us. If we are living holy enough lives, it won't be so scary.
Yeah, very good. Any others? Very quiet this morning. Joseph.
Love can increase or decrease. If our love, we feel, decrease, if we pray, God can increase our love as a church, as a family.
That's very good, very, very important, because it says here that, you know, Paul prays for the love to increase. So the implication of that is, you know, that it could decrease.
Yeah.
So we need to, if we feel it's not as much as it ought to be, we ought to be praying for God to increase that.
Yeah.
Yes, thank you. Barrington, are you stretching or wanting to speak? Both, yeah, a bit of both, a bit of a mixture.
The way we live our lives should reflect the will of God, so prior to his return, there's nothing on our list, you know, that we need to do.
Could you say that again? I didn't catch that, so they may not have...
I'm saying the way we live our lives today should reflect God's will,
yep.
So that prior to his return, there's nothing on our list that we need to do.
Okay, very good. Prior to his return, there is nothing on our list that we need to do. Key things for me as I look back over this morning, three things. Our lives should be, as Yosef was saying, our lives should be overflowing with God's love. Our primary purpose in life is to please God. And sex within marriage should be holy. Let's stand together. Let me pray for you as we... come to the end of this morning. I'm going to take a few moments, opportunity for you to make your own response to God and to maybe something you want to say to him, and then I'm going to pray for us together. Father God, thank you that your word is so relevant and up to date. Thank you that as we read this, even though it's nearly 2,000 years old, it applies to us just as much today. Father God, I pray for us here this morning, for all of us, that you will help us live lives that are pleasing to you. Father, this week, as we face different situations, different challenges, I want to pray for every one of us here that the decisions we make, the things that we do all the time will be things that are pleasing to you, that we will bring honor and glory to you, that we will please you in our decisions, in our lives, every moment this week. Father, help us to be living lives that are ready for your Son to return. Father, we look forward to that day. We say, come, Lord Jesus, come quickly, Lord Jesus, and help us to be ready with nothing on our list that needs to be done before he comes. Help us to be living ready for his return. And Father, we thank you for the wonder of sex and sexuality that you have made, that you have created. And Father, help us to be people to take your word seriously in the way that we live our lives. That the expression of our sexuality is holy and honorable all the time. So, Father God, we commit ourselves now into your presence. We ask you to take hold of us. I ask you, Father, to fill us afresh with your Spirit, that we may be people who are effective in living our lives in this generation. In Jesus' name, amen.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching and other videos at gbcweb.tv. And before you go, an invitation especially for you. Why not visit us at Greenford Baptist Church on the corner of Beechwood Avenue and Ruislip Road in Greenford, West London, the United Kingdom. Our phone number is 020 8575 5034 and our TV website is gbcweb.tv. We look forward to seeing you soon.